Welcome to It's Your Wealthy podcast edition. I'm certified financial planner David Somerville. I'm here with registered retirement consultant Jason Pollock. Jason, good evening. How are you?
Wonderful. How are you?
Awesome.
Beautiful summer's here. Summer night.
Great summer night in the city of St. Catharines. I'm looking outside today. There's no homeless in the back. Just kidding.
No. The homeless. Not yet. Oh, my day's God. Not over.
Don't get me started on the homeless. But I digress. But no, we're talking right now about mistakes managing your own money. And I want to get into this topic, Jason, because I've had in the last few months, I've had lots of conversations about or with people about, you know, those that manage their own wealth, right? And you and I have both got through it ourselves, because I remember back probably in the mid-90s, I started in the industry, and, you know, back then we had a half a dozen mutual funds or whatever it was. And, you know, we'd invest in these mutual funds. And now obviously there's different structures, and there's, you know, there's index holdings and there's private pools and so on. There's different options today. But back then I thought, you know, I'm going to start to read the newspaper and read the, you know, the business section. And my buddy and I would sit down and look at a couple stocks, and it was amazing how we just never seemed to make any money when we tried to, you know, pick stocks and pick winners and pick losers. I mean, have you ever had any experience doing that?
Well, I mean, back in early 2000, just around the same time, it was the dot-com craze. And of course, everybody was, you know, the internet was new, and the E-Trade, yep, had all those great commercials. And hey, oh, of course, we got caught up in it and did really well for a couple of months. And then, you know, the dot-com crash came, and that killed it. You know, same thing happened then in 2008. Everybody got excited and started saying they can do it yourself. And sure enough, they get wiped out. It happens. It's a cycle, right?
It's cyclical, yeah. Right? And it's amazing how, you know, everybody in 2021, markets were going well and everybody started to do their own thing and they got wiped out. I mean, even with Bitcoin, I had a bunch of people come in here in late 2021. Bitcoin was flying through the roof, yeah, and everybody wanted to buy Bitcoin, and they wanted to buy all these different tokens and different types of things. And again, it's amazing when, you know, things get promoted and things get pumped, and, you know, on TV, you turn on the TV and it's, you know, invest yourself and do all these great things. And then things change, right? And then investors get wiped out, and smart money comes in, and smart money, the big money, the institutional money comes in, and they buy up all these investments at low rock bottom prices. I mean, how many people, I've talked to people right now that, you know, they had, one of the highest flying stocks right now is NVIDIA. And, you know, a lot of folks bought it and sold it back in 22. And, you know, NVIDIA had a really bad time, and market fell, and NVIDIA stock fell, and they sold it. And yet NVIDIA has come back to be one of the darlings on the U.S. stock market.
Well, so you're talking to somebody who's had NVIDIA, made a little bit of money, but of course, I thought I was super smart and sold out at, about $170. And wow, a few months ago it hit what, 1100.
So you missed the 5X.
Yeah.
Right. There was a great,
I'm really good at it.
You would have bought yourself a new car for that, right?
I made one of these mistakes that we're going to talk about.
Exactly,
for sure.
Right. So let's get into this, Jason. Yeah. Some of the mistakes that managing your own money causes people. Like, what are some of the things that we know?
Yeah, well, number one is you don't understand the investments. I mean, Warren Buffett talks about this all the time. He cautions people regularly. He says, if you don't understand the business model or understand what you're getting into, then you probably shouldn't do it. You talked about Bitcoin. I get questioned all the time. Should I buy Bitcoin? And personally, me, I don't understand it. I have no idea what it's about. I get little bits of it, but at the end of the day, I say, you know what? That's for somebody that's a lot smarter than me. You know, if you want to invest in Bitcoin, go somewhere else, because I don't understand it. And if you don't understand it, then it's probably not for you.
Yeah, I mean, I've met many people who, you know, I always ask them, do you do your own stocks? Do you buy your own stocks? Do you invest with an investor or an advisor? And they do their own stocks, and I'll ask them, name me two or three of your stocks, and they'll give me two or three of their stocks. And I'll say, okay, so if I take away the CEO, the one that you know, if I take away Elon Musk on Tesla, and we know what Tesla is, obviously, but name me two or three executives beneath the CEO. Yeah. They don't know who the executives are. When I ask them what their two or three core products are, they don't know. When I ask them, you know, have you seen financial statements? They haven't seen financial statements. Do you know what their future earnings looks like, their free cash flow? Like, so when you start asking them some technical questions on a stock, I'll say to them, so you don't know who runs the company. You don't know what their really core product is. You haven't read their financials. You don't know what their free cash flow is like. So you're making this decision with your capital, yet you know nothing of that company. So it's fool's gold, right? Yeah. I mean, at some point, you know, you might get away with it like you did. You bought it for 125, it went to 180. Yeah. But again, you didn't know that that stock had a chance to go to $1,000,
yeah, right? You're exactly right.
You sold it way too early. Number two here on some of the mistakes that you make managing your own money is falling in love with a company. So too often we see a company we've invested in do well. It's easy to fall in love when stocks are going up, right? We bought this investment, it's going up. Also to remember that, you know, stocks go down. And what sometimes happens is that you fall in love with a company. I love the company, but the stock has changed. The earnings have changed. The market's changed.
Like CEO has changed.
The CEO, things have changed, right? Yeah. So as much as you fall in love with a stock, it's not till death do us part. It's, hey, I bought it. I'm going to hold on to it for a period of time. When the fundamentals look good, I'm going to keep buying that stock or buy more of it, keep holding it. But if things change, obviously, you have to at some point look at, you know, what's my exit out of this stock at some point in the future.
Yeah, when I first started, it was Nortel.
Oh, Nortel.
So yeah. I started in 99, and Nortel was obviously the number one stock in Canada, and people just piled more money, more, like, it's all they wanted to do. They didn't diversify. They just bought Nortel, and they watched it and continued on as it just sank to nothing.
Let me tell you a quick story about Nortel. So I met a lady years and years ago. I went to see her one time. She was a client of ours, and she had a little bit of investments with us. And I was sitting with her over a cup of coffee, and I said, you know, do you own any stocks outside of these stocks? And she says, I own Nortel. And she had got Nortel on a spinoff from Bell Canada. Long story short, she had $1 million of Nortel stock. Now, Nortel was trading at about $120 a share. So it was on this climb that lasted for a number of years, the number one stock in the Canadian TSX. Yeah. And I said to her, have you ever thought about selling part of your position? And she said, why would I do that? It's going to go to 240. I said, so it's gone from basically zero to 120 over a short period of time, and you feel it's going to go to $240? Really? And she said, besides, look at the tax I'm going to pay. And I said, you're going to pay the tax because you've made a lot of money.
Right.
So I said to her, why don't you at least cash out half your position? Take $500K, put that aside, go play in a different portfolio or do something else with it and keep a $500,000. And she said no. And we now know that stock went from 124 down to basically zero. Yeah. Right. So again, shame on her. Should have sold it. Pigs get fat, hogs get slaughtered. We know the story, right?
Yeah, exactly. One of the other kind of common mistakes is not monitoring your performance of your investments. So again, similar to that, you're not paying attention. You don't know what's happening in the market. You don't know, maybe there's some change in management, and you're focused on one specific stock. But it's important to remember you've got to have a diversified portfolio. That usually allows you to balance out some of the negatives and the positives. And instead of riding the horse of one stock, it rarely pays off.
Well, you know what I always say, are you a speculator or are you an investor? So speculation is, I might own a couple stocks, I'm going to speculate, I'm going to try and get rich quick, but the investor is well diversified. I mean, if you look at it, you know, we do know that the greatest investor of all time is Warren Buffett. Warren Buffett doesn't just own one stock, he owns a multiple number of stocks in different areas, different categories, different sectors. So yeah, diversification and monitoring your portfolio is critical. Number four here is letting your emotions rule. So perhaps, Jason, the number one killer of investment return is emotion. I mean, we know that, right? I mean, again, you had this emotion where I bought NVIDIA at 125, it went to 175, 180. Emotionally, hey, I made a nice return. And you did, right? You made a great return, yet you didn't know that the greatest days of that stock were coming just up into the future, right? So again, the fear and the greed rule the market, right?
Yeah.
Investors should not let fear or greed control their decisions. And this is the big issue with, I think, managing your own money is, you know, you've made a lot of money. You think you have. Maybe the stock's got a much longer road to go. But again, you feel like I've made enough money and we move on. The technicals and the fundamentals don't match up. The other big thing is, man, I bought that stock. It's a great stock, but it's down 25% in the last 6 months. And again, the fear, it's going to keep going down. Yeah. You know, one of my good friends who ran a casino for years said to me, he said, do you know why we always win at the casino? He says, because what happens is people come in and the winners don't know when to walk away and the losers walk away too quick. So he says, we get a busload of people coming in. They're all excited to go hit their jackpot at, you know, Falls View Casino. And he says, half of them in the first hour will win, right? And they really should walk away because they've been winning, right, aggressively. But they don't. They don't want to walk away because of greed.
Yeah.
I'm going to make more. And the loser comes in off the bus, and the first hour, they just get decimated. They can't win a card hand, and they lose on the slot machine. And he says, and they walk away. What they should be doing is they should be playing more because eventually the, you know, the odds change. So he says, it's a perfect storm. It's the reason why, you know, we That's make funny. $300 to $400 million a year in net profit is winners don't know when to walk away. And losers get afraid, they're fearful, and they don't stick around long enough for it to rebound. So yeah. Markets are almost the same animal.
Yeah, I have a theory about casinos. I truly believe that 8 out of 10 times you go into a casino, you're up 20% at some point.
Yeah.
But you don't walk away. Yeah. Just like he said, the winners don't walk away. If I brought it $200 and I'm up $40, am I gonna say thank you very much? No. I'm not.
Well, it's amazing, right? So the winners, they're winning. And then what happens is they get greedy and they think, man, if I was playing $25 exactly. chips, I'd be up $500 yeah. as opposed Increase to $125. The so they're yeah. increasing the bet, but the odds are going to turn, right? It's, yeah. what is it, 52-48 or whatever yeah. the probability factor is of the casino winning. And then the loser is afraid to kind of double down and stay the course, right? So fear and greed drives profit in the casino, and fear and greed drives profit for the stock market, but in most cases, not for the average investor.
Exactly, exactly. One of the other mistakes is waiting to get even. Again, we talked about Nortel. People were so fixated on Nortel, and it's going to come back. It's going to come back. I had a personal situation with BlackBerry, the same idea. Not understanding what was happening in the market, I kept buying BlackBerry because I felt that this, at some point, is going to get back to even. And I kept buying at little at stages as it's dropping, and never recovered. So you have to, it's all about behavior and emotion. We've talked about it a number of times. It's really important. Take your loss on some of them. If it's not meant to be, it's not meant to be on certain stocks.
You know, I just came back from a big conference in California a few months ago. It was a Fidelity conference, and they had all their top portfolio managers there. And when you sit there and listen to these people, first of all, the education they have behind them is incredible. Mm-hmm. They all typically spend, you know, 8 to 10 years as an analyst, and they've got different sectors, so they know exactly how sectors work. They've got a team of hundreds and hundreds of analysts that can actually do the due diligence, write the papers, write the notes. You know, you look at that team of professionals that's running a position of a portfolio, and you say to yourself, how can anybody on their own mm-hmm. compete? We're talking about David and Goliath. You know, David is the little investor, pardon the pun, not me, but, you know, there's David and then there's Goliath. And now that fable actually turned out well for David, but it doesn't turn out well for the stock market. The little investor over time is a donator.
Yeah.
And the big investors are the ones that know exactly what's happening. They know where things are headed. So again, it's a tough ring to be in. Is when you're a little investor with not a lot of education, not a lot of knowledge, not a lot of contacts, you're not doing any due diligence. It's mostly just, my buddy said to buy it, yeah. I want to buy it, I like
See
the stock.
On the news.
I use the product, yeah. right? So that's not a way to create long-term wealth. If you want right. to take, and again, I'm big on this. I tell clients all the time, if you want to speculate and play some stock, play yeah. some penny stocks, play a couple stocks, play a technology stock, play a Bitcoin, I'm cool with that. Take 10% of your wealth and speculate. Nothing exactly. wrong with that. Yep. But take the 90% of your wealth and go get some professional institutional money managers, professional traders, professional investment people on your side. You know, close your eyes, diversify 10, 15, 20 years, you come back, you're never going to be disappointed. It'll always turn out well for you.
Agreed.
Right. Jason Pollock, again, thanks for coming on tonight. Really appreciate
it. Great. Thank you.
And for those, for those out there, don't forget to share the podcast if you like it. We're on Apple iTunes, we're on Spotify, and we're on YouTube. And again, till next week, next month.
Next month.
One a month, right? Until next month, have a great month, and we'll talk to you soon.